the years of which I have spoken to you, when I pursued the inner images, were the most important time of my life. Everything else is to be derived from this. It began at that time, and the later details hardly matter anymore. My entire life consisted in elaborating what had burst forth from the unconscious and flooded me like an enigmatic stream and threatened to break me. That was the stuff and material for more than only one life. Everything later was merely the outer classification, the scientific elaboration, and the integration into life. But the numinous beginning, which contained everything, was then. C. G. Jung, 1957. And that is written on the back of the Red Book. Welcome to a video where we will be discussing and exploring and reading some of Carl Jung's Red Book. I hope you are doing well. For those of you new to my channel or new to this particular series, I am speaking in this format in order to help relax viewers watching. As far as this series goes, I acquired Carl Jung's Red Book because I have felt drawn towards who he was and what he taught, because I feel some personal similarities, like-mindedness in some of the things that he's done and taught about. And I just think he was also a profound human being. He wrote volumes of work. He also tried to help people, help them by teaching them by not teaching them, but having them more or less draw and paint and things like that, to kind of work through and express themselves and everything like that. And he was also a very talented artist. He was an artist, he was a healer, and he was a father. And I want to do this video, this format, and in any future videos. I don't want to just read verbatim what he wrote. I want to kind of analyze what he wrote to the best that I can. I'm not a scholar. I never went to college. I went to the school of hard knocks. I finished high school and that was about it. So, sit back, lay back, relax, and we're gonna get started with Liber Primus, I believe is how you might say it. He spent 15, 16 years writing this. And this was pretty much the basis of, from what I gather and from what I understand, everything that he's ever wrote in his life. He basically tried to explore his own subconscious, consciousness and unconsciousness, and tried to understand his mind and the workings and of the mind and things like that. And that's just a very high level take on it. So we're gonna get started. The title here says, The Way of What Is to Come. And it looks like it might be written in Latin, maybe German. But there's two sections here, actually three sections. I'm sorry. Yeah, it looks like there are three little sections that he prefaces his main writing. So I'm going to read the first section, and three of them are from what I believe is the Bible. So the first section. Isaiah said, Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid it, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Isaiah 53:1-4. And there's a footnote. It says, in 1921, Jung cited the first three verses of this passage from Luther's Bible, noting, in quotes, the birth of the Savior, the development of the redeeming symbol, takes place where one does not expect it, and from precisely where a solution is most improbable. And there's also a note here about, I think it might be in another book, Psychological Types. So I want to analyze this, because he basically said, as Isaiah said, that here comes this tender plant. Out of a dry ground where you least expect it, right? If we're going to talk about Jesus Christ, nothing attractive about him, and you know, you think about Jesus and you think about you know, the Son of God, why I think that he quoted that, because Carl Jung talks a lot about God, but I believe the God that he talks about is the God within us, the not just, it's not any kind of religious God. is the God within us. It is that almost perfect level of, or achieving almost perfection. I mean, there is no such thing as perfection. And he noted the birth of the Savior, the development of the redeeming symbol takes place where one does not expect it. Like Jesus, right? Born to, Son of God, born where no one would expect it. And from precisely where a solution is most improbable. And I think that, aside from the Bible and all that, because he's just quoting that. He's not really trying to promote the Bible or anything like that, from what I understand. But he's trying to talk about, whether or not Jesus did exist, whatever. My take on this, and again, this is just my opinion and my view, and I'm doing this to see if you might think the same way. But is that the Savior, is that the thing that we are looking for can often come from a place where we least expect it, an improbable place, even within us, even the answers that we seek, the things that are going to save us is not out there, necessarily. Not where we would expect, not from an idol, not from things that we are taught, but deep in here, however you want to think of it. That's how I take about it. That's my take on it. Then he writes, I don't want to get too much into the God and religious kind of aspect of things, but and analyze each paragraph too long either. So the next section he quotes from Isaiah 9:6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. And there's another footnote. In 1921, Jung cited this passage, noting, in quotes, the nature of the redeeming symbol is that of a child. That is, the childlikeness or presuppositionlessness of the attitude belongs to the symbol and its function. This childlike attitude necessarily brings with it another guiding principle in place of self-will and rational intentions, whose godlikeness is synonymous with superiority. Since it is of an irrational nature, the guiding principle appears in a miraculous form. Isaiah expresses his connection very well in Isaiah 9:5. Then he goes on, these honorific titles reproduce the essential qualities of the redeeming symbol. The criterion of godlike effect is the irresistible power of the unconscious impulses. So, my take thus far, and what I think Jung talks about a lot, is God, and even if, there may not have necessarily been a Jesus, but this Savior, this redeeming quality, this symbol that be kind to one another and love, and let's love thy neighbor and all the positive aspects of Christianity, is that there is the redeeming symbol is that of a child, the innocence of a child, And that is the collective unconsciousness. It is very childlike. It has basic needs and basic wants. He talks about this childlike attitude brings it with it a guiding principle in place of self-will and rational intentions. Since it is of an irrational nature, the guiding principle appears in a miraculous form. And it's almost like that aha moment, you know, that, and this is my take, and all throughout this video, any points you want to comment, or correct me, or, you know, things like that, it's fine, or your opinion, it's all just, you know, we're all just exploring here. But, you know, you think about the Son of God, and you think about God, and you think about ourselves, and why we're really here, and our purpose, and things like that. And there is this, just this, this inner child, or this, this redeeming factor. It is, I guess, is childlike. It comes to us from a place we don't expect it, and I'm kind of hitting a wall here, but hopefully that makes a little sense, and you get the gist of what I'm trying to say. I'm not the best at trying to explain. I understand, and I can't explain what I understand all the time as well. And Jung kind of talks to that, and we'll get to that. All right, the next passage, there's a third one here. There's going to be a fourth one as well. John said, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." John 1:14. And there's a no footnote there. and I think what that, again, you know, they're most likely talking about Jesus or whoever this person was, or perhaps it was someone that said how we're living. This person had some kind of insight, whether Jesus, whoever Jesus was, and whoever they're writing about at that time, either all of them or someone had this revelation that we shouldn't be living this way. We should be living more peaceful. And of course, they crucified, apparently, or they killed the idea. Whether Jesus really existed, whether he really was crucified. But the whole point is that this idea, this revelation that was written and turned into the Bible or whatever, you know, the symbol was a child is born, this idea is born. This revelation that is as close to perfection that we can achieve. And that's my understanding. All right, moving on. Isaiah said, "The wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. Then the lame man leap as a hart, H-A-R-T, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out, and streams in the desert. And the parched ground shall become a pool, in the thirsty land, springs of water, in the habitation of dragons, where each lay shall be grass with reeds and rushes, and a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those. The wayfaring men, though fools, shall not err therein. Isaiah 35:1-8. And there's another footnote. Jung noted that the union of the opposites of the destructive and constructive powers of the unconscious paralleled the messianic state of fulfillment depicted in this passage. Now, I'm not sure, the messianic state of fulfillment depicted in this passage, and that is the Messiah state of fulfillment. The union of the opposites of the destructive and constructive powers of the unconscious parallel the messianic state of fulfillment. So again, it's more, I think, that, you know, this state, this ultimate form, this whatever it is deep within our subconscious or unconscious, and this ultimate way of achieving oneness and holiness is not necessarily a religious thing, but us achieving greatness is what, you know, that is something that almost anyone can achieve, and that's pretty much my interpretation. I'd love to hear what you think. So now we're going to get into more of his writings. We're done with the introductory passages there that he's quoted. The next passage, or the next part, it says here, written by C.G. Jung with his own hand in his house in Kusnacht, Kusnacht, Zurich, in the year 1915. If I speak in the spirit of this time, then I want to say something that when he talks about the spirit of this time, he's talking about the current, from what I understand, my take on this, and you might want you to think about this, just because if you not quite understand what the spirit of this time means, that I had to try to figure out myself. And the spirit of this time is our mindsets today in this world. This the way we act, the things that we see and participate in, the systems that we have, the mindset, how we interact with each other, that there is like a current way of living. And that's how I feel what he means by that. If I speak in the spirit of the time, and there's a footnote in, is it Goethe's or Goethe's Faust? Faust says to Wagner, what you call the spirit of the times is fundamentally the gentleman's own mind in which the times are reflected. So if I speak in the spirit of this time, if I speak in the spirit of my mind in the way that the times are reflected, I must say, no one and nothing can justify what I must proclaim to you. Justification is superfluous to me, since I have no choice, but I must. And he's saying that what he's about to say, that no one can really justify, and justification doesn't matter to him because he feels the need to do this. Just like I'm doing this, just like I'm here on YouTube, I feel like I've been a puppet on strings, and I have been led by something. It could be me wanting to do this, but I think there's something deeper within me that wants me to create and do these videos and do and talk about this. I mean, so it's kind of the same thing. I have learned that in addition to the spirit of this time, there is still another spirit at work, namely that which rules the depths of everything contemporary. Another footnote. The draft continues, because this was taken from a draft, a lot of his drafts, and then, quote, "And then one whom I did not know, but who evidently had such knowledge, said to me, 'What a strange task you have. You must disclose your innermost and lowermost,' unquote. This I resisted, since I hated nothing more than that which seemed to me unchaste and insolent." And so he says there's another spirit at work, that which rules the depths of everything contemporary. And he's talking there, the spirit of this time, his conscious mind. You know, everything that we, everything contemporary, everything current, not contemporary. I'm not familiar with the word contemporary that well. The spirit of this time is everything today, in today's world. And then the spirit of the depths, that's the unconscious. That's where the shadow is. That is within all of us. That is which goes back, you know, thousands of years and has been around, that's fear. That's all that stuff that everybody has. That is timeless, right? So that's deep within our conscious or unconscious. And then there's what's the spirit of the time and what's in our consciousness. So there's a lot of those battles between how we live today and that we also struggle with. And then that which is deep, deep, which doesn't live by these rules. And that's my take. The spirit of this time would like to hear of use and value. I also thought this way, and my humanity still thinks this way. But that other spirit forces me nevertheless to speak beyond justification, use, and meaning. Filled with human pride and blinded by the presumptuous spirit of the times, I long sought to hold that other spirit away from me. And he's saying he doesn't care about deep within what he feels is right or what he should listen to, but he's rather more concerned about the world, the outside, and the current state of times and things that he's driven to do with his pride and things. But I did not consider that the spirit of the depths, from time immemorial, and for all the future, possesses a greater power than the spirit of this time, who changes with the generations. And that's true. You have the deep within us, the unchanging things that make us who we are that we don't really fully understand. You know, the dreams and you know what creates dreams and fear and things like that. He did not consider that that had more power than the spirit of this time, who changes with the generations. And our mindsets change from generation to generation, but one thing never changes, who we are, right? That's, again, this is all my take. The spirit of the depths has subjugated all pride and arrogance to the power of judgment. He took away my belief in science. He robbed me of the joy of explaining and ordering things, and he let devotion to the ideals of this time die out in me. He forced me down to the last and simplest things, and that's how I feel I am at right now. You know, Carl Jung was in his 40s when he began to write this and go on this 16-year endeavor, of trying to understand himself and his consciousness and unconsciousness. You know, and it's saying that he as he started this, from what I understand, as he began to write about this, his exploration and talking, trying to understand his unconsciousness and all of that, that it took away his belief in science, and it robbed him of his joy of explaining things, and it let his devotion to the ideals of this time die out. It forced him down to the last and simplest things. And that's how I feel. I've always believed in that motto, keep it simple, stupid. Sometimes we get so caught up in the details of things and explaining things and ordering things and belief in science. And I used to, you know, science, explain everything in this, and just like that video I did before this one. Yeah, on existentialism, and you know, trying to explain everything, and we don't really need to. We just need to live, and allow everything. Okay, there's possibilities of things that is, you know, beyond things that we know that science can easily explain. And the devotion to the ideals of this time died out in him. His devotion to the things that that he believes in himself, or you know, and things like that, and forced him down to become a simple man in a way. That's my take, at least on spirit of the depths took my understanding, and the spirit of the depths, again, from what I understand, is that which resides deep within the unconscious. Took his understanding and all my knowledge and placed them at the service of the inexplicable and the paradoxical. He robbed me of speech and writing for everything that was not in his service, namely the melting together of sense and nonsense, which produces the supreme meaning. And again, I've mentioned this in, I think, only one video here and there, or some recent videos. There's no right or wrong. There's sense and nonsense. And when you bring them together, that's what life is all about. When you can understand sense and nonsense, you know. I don't mean nonsense cartoons and sense, you know, the world is round and enjoying them. I just mean that when you feel within you and in your own understanding of what makes sense and what doesn't make sense, and you can bring them together and you can accept them, I guess. But again, this is his writing. In his journey, and it doesn't necessarily apply to us, but there are things that I think that we can take away from this, and that's kind of the whole purpose of this, you know, because a lot of us are, you know, we have questions about us, ourselves, and things that we think about, and are we alone? And he says a lot of things that I can relate to, and if I can relate to it, and you can relate to, and others can relate to, then we're not alone in the way we think, and there must be something. There must be a truth to the way that we think. And even if I'm the only one that can relate, well, then I know that I'm not crazy. That's right, that's what it is. When you think these things, does anyone else think this way? And when someone else thinks it the way that you do, it can be a big revelation, a big moment. But the supreme, now this is in italic writing. But the supreme meaning is the path, the way, and the bridge to what is to come. That is the God yet to come. It is not the coming God himself, but his image which appears in the supreme meaning. God is an image, and those who worship him must worship him in the images of the supreme meaning. The supreme meaning is not a meaning and not an absurdity. It is image and force in one, magnificence and force together. The supreme meaning is the beginning and the end. It is the bridge of going across and fulfillment. The other gods died of their temporality. Yet the supreme meaning never dies. It turns into meaning and then into absurdity. And out of the fire and blood of their collision, the supreme meaning rises up, rejuvenated anew. The image of God has a shadow. The supreme meaning is real and casts a shadow. For what can be actual and corporeal and have no shadow? The shadow is nonsense. It lacks force and has no continued existence through itself. But nonsense is the inseparable and undying brother of the supreme meaning. Like plants, so men also grow, some in the light, others in the shadows. There are many who need the shadows and not the light. The image of God throws a shadow that is just as great as itself. The supreme meaning is great and small. It is as wide as the space of the starry heaven and as narrow as the cell of the living body. And what I understand is, this is a little deep for me. I don't quite fully understand the supreme meaning, but what he's talking about, nonsense, the shadow, and things like that, is that, you know, we can make sense of a lot of things, and God speaking to us in images, and there's always been stuff about Moses and the burning bush, and so much symbolism throughout the ages in the human race, and that sometimes our deep unconscious, and there's dreams, and the unconscious, you know, it doesn't make sense. It's nonsense. It's fantasy. It's idea. It's dream, and the supreme meaning. I understand it, but I'm having a hard time explaining it to you. But hopefully, you might understand that. All right. There is another footnote. The terms going across, going down, and bridge feature in Nietzsche's Zarathustra, in relation to the passage from man to the Superman. For example, quote, "What is great in man is that he is a bridge and not a goal. What can be loved in man is that he is a going across and a going down. I love those who do not know how to live, except their lives be a going, a down going, for they are those who are going over." And I think there's some great stuff in here that means a lot, and I try to wrap my head around it. And what I get from that is that we are not a goal. We are going somewhere. And the same with our understanding, especially of ourselves. And those who live I love those who do not know how to live except their lives by down going, for they are those who are going over. And that was Friedrich Nietzsche. I never pronounced his last name correctly. I wrote that Nietzsche. You know, there are people who are gonna cross over, or gonna evolve, or gonna progress in their lives because they are. You know, I don't quite understand that going down, but I understand what we're getting at here. That they're going deep within themselves, and they think about things, and they're the ones who are going to progress. And for the most part, that's my take on it. They're going to understand, and they're going to progress in their own lives because they're doing a lot of reflecting and going deep within their minds and trying to understand more about life and themselves. That's my take on it. Yours might be different, or other scholars out there. But you know, I'm not really here to profess to be an expert. I just kind of average Joe kind of take on it. Spirit of this time in me wanted to recognize the greatness and extent of the supreme meaning, but not its littleness. So the spirit of this time, his mindset and all that, wanted to recognize the greatness and extent of the supreme meaning, but didn't want to have anything to do with its, consider its littleness, right? That's ego. The spirit of the depths, however, what's in his unconscious, conquered this arrogance, and I had to swallow the small as a means of healing the immortal in me, the immortal in him, that which has been around, that which has been within us forever, since, you know, we evolved. It completely burnt up my innards, since it was inglorious and unheroic. It was even ridiculous and revolting, but the pliers of the spirit of the depths held me, and I had to drink the bitterest of all draughts. And another footnote, that Jung seems to be referring to episodes that occur later in the text. In the text, the healing of Izdubar in his next section, and the drinking of the bitter drink prepared by the solitary. I don't quite understand, and I haven't really read myself. Alright, we're going to continue. The spirit of this time tempted me with the thought that all this belongs to the shadowiness of the God image. This would be pernicious deception, since the shadow is nonsense. But the small, narrow, and banal is not nonsense, but one of both of the essences of the Godhead. I resisted recognizing that the everyday belongs to the image of the Godhead. I fled this thought. I hid myself behind the highest and coldest stars, but the spirit of the depths caught up with me and forced the bitter drink between my lips. And there's a footnote, the draft continues, in quotes, "Who drinks this drink will never again thirst for this world, nor for the afterlife, since he drank crossing and completion. He drank the hot melting river of life, which congeals to hard ore in his soul and awaits new melting and mixture." All right, so what does that mean? He drinks of will never thirst for this world nor for the afterlife, since he drank crossing and completion. Meaning that when you, well, I understand, when you accept what you are, who you are, and everything about you, and your fears, and everything, and you really, you no longer thirst for this world we live in. I no longer have the need for material possessions, for money, for all this stuff. It means nothing. And you're also not worried about afterlife because you realize what's in you, what the present is, what matters, and how you live your life in here, and in here, your heart, your mind, well, your mind probably mostly. That's my take on it. The spirit of this time whispered to me, this supreme meaning, this image of God, this melting together of the hot and the cold, that is you and only you. But the spirit of the depths spoke to me, you are an image of the unending world, all the last mysteries of becoming and passing away live in you. If you did not possess all this, how could you know? So we are an image, and he was saying that he's an image of the unending world. All the last mysteries of becoming and passing away live in you. So that everything there is about, you know, it is within us. If you think about it, everything that we need to know is not out there, but right in here. That's the image of God. Not that there's a God, a holy God or a religious God, but the God is in here. That the Godhead, it is sense and nonsense. It is just, that's how I take, that's my take. My very uneducated guess. And it's getting really good here. For the sake of my human weakness, the spirit of the depths gave me this word. Yet this word is also superfluous, since I do not speak it freely, but because I must. I speak because the spirit robs me of joy and life if I do not speak. Footnote. Draft continues, he who knows understands me and sees that I am not lying. May each one inquire of his own depth whether he needs what I say. And he's saying that if you understand what I'm talking about, you know I'm not lying. And that may you, me, you, everyone else, question yourself as to if you need what he's talking about. So that, because he was kind of worried, and I said in here, he was worried that people think he's crazy, because he really did have conversations with himself. And I'm just saying that a very basic, that's a simplification. But that right there, and that's what he said here. I must speak because the spirit robs me of joy in life if I do not speak. That's like me here doing this, or a lot of artists. If I don't do this, I'm not happy. I am the serf who brings it and does not know what he... Okay, let's continue. I left there a footnote. So I speak because the spirit robs me of joy in life if I do not speak. I am the serf who brings it and does not know what he carries in his hand. It would burn his hands if he did not place it where his master orders him to lay it. That is two of the most profound statements and sentences I have ever read in my life, and I mean that. I've been saying this over the last year, that I am, or the last couple years, coming here to YouTube and becoming a father and expressing all this, and, you know, I know that I feel the need to create, and I love all that I'm inspired by, but why? Why am I doing this? What is the point, right? My whole purpose as a human being is to eat and have reproductive organs to mate, right? That's at a core evolutionary level. That's who I am. and that's how I got here. Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this? I don't know. I can't explain. I'm driven to do this. I have been, in my mind, questioning. I have been driven to do this, and we are all driven. A lot of people are driven to express themselves. It's not because I'm hungry. Not because I don't want money right now. I'm not doing this for money, really. I'm not hungry. I ate. I'm not thirsty. And, so there's no appetite right now as to why I want to do this, other than I am compelled to do this, to share this, to talk about, to discuss, to learn, to teach. Not that I'm a teacher. I don't think I'm arrogant. But I am the serf who brings it, and he does not know what he carries in his hand. He would burn his hands if he did not place it where his... It would burn my hands if I did not do this. And that's kind of what he's saying. Though he's not talking about art or anything, he's talking about what I understand is that he was talking about why he decided to do and write the Red Book and all these drafts and go into that deep inner exploration of himself. But that's how I feel, that my take on this, how I feel as an artist. Or a creative type. I hate saying artist. Sometimes it sounds arrogant and pretentious when I say that. So I prefer creative type, or creative archetype, or whatever that is within me that drives me. And I've been saying that all these things that I do, yeah, I know it's fun and it's creative and all this, but you know, why am I driven and all that? And it's, there's something within me. I'm a puppet on strings. I've been saying that for years. All right, enough about me. Let's continue. That I'm just trying to explain how I can relate to that. The spirit of our time spoke to me and said, "What dire urgency could be forcing you to speak all this?" This was an awful temptation. I wanted to ponder what inner or outer bind could force me into this. And because I found nothing that I could grasp, I was near to making one up. But with this, the spirit of our time had almost brought it about that instead of speaking, I was thinking again about reasons and explanations. But the spirit of the depths spoke to me and said, "To understand a thing is a bridge and possibility of returning to the path, but to explain a matter is arbitrary and sometimes even murder. Have you counted the murderers among the scholars?" And my take on that is that, you know, when you understand something, you know, it's a bridge and it's a possibility of returning to the path, getting you where you're going, just by understanding. But to explain a matter is arbitrary and sometimes even murder. You know, to explain why and how. You know, that's not the point. Like, why are people depressed? Where does depression come from? Maybe that's not the best. What's a good example? I don't know what a good example. Let's just say, and this might, I'm not sure this is a good analogy or example, but let's just say the heat of the sun, right? Or existence. It doesn't matter how I try to explain it. And what matters is that we understand we exist. We understand we get heat from the sun. So let it be. We don't really need to explain it. There's no purpose in that. Some things you cannot explain, so why get caught up? And because you're getting off of your path. You're spending too much time trying to explain what doesn't need to be explained because it's really arbitrary. So just understand it. And then if you just understand things and not try to explain everything, you know, to a degree, you'll just continue down. And that's how I am right now in my life. I used to analyze everything to death. you know, the systems and all this, and even decisions get caught up in this cycle of, you know, paralysis by analysis, as the saying goes. And now I just take things, and at face value, I try not to delve too deep into them. I'm not trying to, just like here, I'm trying to understand what he says and explain a little bit about it, and then just move on and continue, you know? So, but the spirit of this time stepped up to me and laid before me huge volumes which contained all my knowledge. Their pages were made of ore, and a steel stylus had engraved inexorable words in them. And he pointed to these inexorable words and spoke to me and said, "What you speak, this is madness." And that's his current state of mind. And the things that he wrote and all this, his current mindset, from what I understand, is that as he went about exploring his unconscious, spirit of time said, "Look at this, what you've learned. This is real. And what you're about to do is insane." More or less, that's my take on it. "It is true, it is true. What I speak is the greatness and intoxication and ugliness of madness." Again, they said that he was kind of concerned that people would think he's crazy. That's why this was never published. Or he never really gives specific instruction to publish it. "But the spirit of the depths stepped up to me and said, 'What you speak is. The greatness is. The intoxication is. The undignified, sick, paltry dailiness is. It runs in all the streets, lives in all the houses, and rules the day of all humanity. Even the eternal stars are commonplace. It is the great mistress and the one essence of God. One laughs about it, and laughter too is. Do you believe, man of this time, that laughter is lower than worship? Where is your measure, false measurer? The sum," end quote. There's a footnote here. This also carries the connotation of the adjective vermessen, that is, a lack or loss of measure, and thus implies overconfidence, presumptuousness. And then it goes on, "The sum of life decides in laughter and in worship, not your judgment." So it's, you know, his current mindset and his current state of mind and everything he's taught in society and everything he's learned and his ideals said this is truth. It's everything you know. And then what you speak about his unconscious and all this, and the spirit of the depths, that is madness. But then his spirit of the depths, and then he says, "It's true. What I speak is the greatness and intoxication and ugliness of madness." But then the spirit of the depths said to him, and he's saying that his unconscious mind, what he felt was right. Said, "What you speak is, what he's talking about is the intoxication, the dailiness of life. It's everywhere. It rules humanity. Even the eternal stars are commonplace. He's the great mistress and the one essence of God. Even this God, whatever that is, you know, has sense and nonsense." I'm trying to really understand this myself as I work this out here. "The sum of life decides in laughter and in worship, not your judgment." And then he goes on, I must also speak the ridiculous. You coming men, so people who might read this, the future of generations to come, you will recognize the supreme meaning by the fact that he is laughter and worship. A bloody laughter and a bloody worship. A sacrificial blood binds the poles. Those who know this laugh and worship in the same. Those who know this laugh and worship in the same breath, saying that we laugh at the madness, at the ridiculousness of who we are or this world we live in, and yet we worship. You know, it's that we worship ourselves. What I'm trying to understand here, you know, that's what I take, the laughter, you know, laughing, the madness, the laughter, the, you know, laughing at some of the things, I guess, of who we are and all this, and then the worship of who we are, that's my take on it. After this, however, my humanity approached me and said, "What solitude, what coldness of desolation you lay upon me when you speak such. Reflect on the destruction of being and the streams of blood from the terrible sacrifice that the depths demand." So that's a reference to a vision that follows. There's a vision he has, actually. And so it's saying his humanity said, what coldness and desolation you lay upon me when you speak about the what the sacrifice that the depths demand, giving, you know, the that his humanity, you know, is saying that the who we are deep, this primal thing, this whatever this is in our unconscious, that addressing it and accepting it and assimilating it into our lives means getting rid of who we are and everything we learned and all of this, and becoming very simple, and that kills, he thinks that would kill his humanity or something. But the spirit, that's again my take. Again, I can't explain it as well. But the spirit of the depth said, no one can or should halt sacrifice. Sacrifice is not destruction. Sacrifice is the foundation stone of what is to come. Have you not had monasteries? Have not countless thousands gone into the desert? You should carry the monastery in yourself. Love that. The desert is within you. The desert calls you and draws you back. And if you were fettered to the world of this time with iron, the call of the desert would break all chains. Truly, I prepare you for solitude. And that's that kind of speaks to being a highly sensitive person in a way. And it's kind of talking, and again, this is more, you know, he doesn't want you, he doesn't want to teach you that this is how you should live. Again, you know, if you feel and understand what he's saying, is it truth? Search within yourself and see what he says makes sense. And that's what I do with everything. I know I take pieces from Christianity, pieces from Buddhism, and make my own, form my own mindset and way of life. And he's saying here that if we were fettered to the world of this time, that within us, that deep who we are as human beings within us would just destroy those chains and take us and take him into solitude. But that he's kind of talking about, from what I understand, what he's about to do, and it's going to break, it's going to take him away from everything that he has lived for, that he's acquired and all this. And it's going to make him really search himself and become solitary to a degree, from what I understand. After this, my humanity remained silent. Something happened to my spirit, however, which I must call mercy. My speech is imperfect, like me, not because I want to shine with words, but out of the impossibility of finding those words. I speak in images. With nothing else can I express the words from the depths. The mercy which happened to me gave me belief, hope, and sufficient daring, not to resist further the spirit of the depths, but to utter his word. But before I could pull myself together to really do it, I needed a visible sign that would show me that the spirit of the depths in me was at the same time the ruler of the depths of world affairs. Then he had a vision here of terrible cold, of a flood, of all this, and I don't really quite understand, but he had a 2-hour long vision. He had this really real life vision. And it made him confused, him, it nauseated him and all this. He tried to understand it. It left him exhausted and confused. Thought he had gone crazy. He also saw a sea of blood over the northern lands when he was leaving alone for a journey in October of the year 1913. In the next year, he had the same dream 3 times. In a foreign land, and suddenly overnight, and right in the middle of summer, a terrible cold descended from space. All seas and rivers were locked in ice. Every green living thing had frozen. And he was in a remote English land when he had this third dream in 1914. And it was necessary that I return to my homeland with a fast ship as speedily as possible. I reached home quickly. In my homeland, I found that in the middle of summer, a terrible cold had fallen from space, which had turned every living thing into ice. And this is his third dream that he's describing. There stood a leaf-bearing but fruitless tree, whose leaves had turned into sweet grapes, full of healing juice through the working of the frost. I picked some grapes and gave them to a great waiting throng. There's a footnote here. Ice wine is made by leaving grapes on the vine until they are frozen by frost. They are then pressed and the ice is removed, leaving to a highly concentrated, delectable, sweet wine. In reality, now it was so. At the time when the Great War broke out between the peoples of Europe, I found myself in Scotland, compelled by the war to choose the fastest ship and the shortest route home. I encountered the colossal cold that froze everything. I met up with the flood, the sea of blood, and found my barren tree, whose leaves the frost had transformed into a remedy. And I plucked the ripe fruit and gave it to you, and I do not know what I poured out for you, what bittersweet intoxicating drink, which left on your tongues an aftertaste of blood. Believe me, is no teach, and this is the, we're going to end here, and this is some more, this just speaks volumes what I'm about to read here. Believe me, it is no teaching and no instruction that I give you. On what basis should I presume to teach you? I give you news of the way of this man, but not of your own way. My path is not your path, therefore I cannot teach you. The way is within us, but not in gods, nor in teachings, nor in laws. Within us is the way, the truth, and the life. To me, this is very just amazing, this whole section I'm about to read. I don't want to repeat myself again, but I can't help it. Woe betide those who live by way of examples. Life is not with those people. If you live according to an example, you thus live the life of that example. But who should live your own life if not yourself? So live yourselves. The signposts have fallen. Unblazed trails lie before us. Do not be greedy to gobble up the fruits of foreign fields. Do you not know that you yourselves are the fertile acre which bears everything that avails you? Yet who today knows this? Who knows the way to the eternally fruitful climes of the soul? You seek the way through mere appearances. You study books and give ear to all kinds of opinion. What good is all that? I'm going to stop there for a second. There is only one way, and that is your way. And that is just so profound. And it's so basic, and it's just saying to each their own. Stop looking to figure out your life by everything that we're taught and laws and all this. Stop trying to figure out your life and live your life according to examples, to laws, to gods. That the way that you should live is here within. When I say like this, I'm not necessarily putting my heart, I just mean within you, within me. Everything I need to know about life is within me. And that's the way. That is the way I should live. It's just, I mean, it's really to each their own. I mean, this is a lot of us know. A lot of us know this, I mean, right? And this was written almost 100 years ago. But it's so true. Don't try to live by someone's example. Even me. I'm not an idol. Don't look up to me or anything like that. But I can't teach you. You know, our teachers can teach us a little about the life, but I can't teach you how to live your life. That's for up to you to figure out. And if there's something that I say that, you know, take pieces, and listen to my advice or what feels like a truth to you, but don't live like me. And he's going to go on like that here. You seek the path, I warn you away from my own. It can also be the wrong way for you. Don't live like someone else. And he's saying the same thing. Don't live like me. May each go his own way. I will be no savior, no lawgiver, no master teacher unto you. You are no longer little children. Giving laws, wanting improvements, making things easier, has all become wrong and evil. May each one seek out his own way. The way leads to mutual love and community. Men will come to see and feel the similarity and commonality of their ways, so that when we all are left to live our lives, when we're not forced to live a certain way and taught to live a certain way, that when I can learn to live this way and end my life as free as we all should, and then we'll see others living the same and we'll have that commonality. And that's community. You know, letting everyone be free, living their own ways. And then people will find like-minded individuals. And that's how communities and those groups will come together and learn and learn to live and with one another. Laws and teachings held in common compel people to solitude, so that they may escape the pressure of undesirable contact. But solitude makes people hostile and venomous. Therefore, give people dignity and let each of them stand apart, so that each may find his own fellowship and love it. That, you know, when we're left to our own accord to live our own lives, we will find fellowship with those that we find similarities with. Power stands against power, contempt against contempt, love against love. Give humanity dignity and trust that life will find the better way. The one eye of the Godhead is blind, the one ear of the Godhead is deaf. The order of its being is crossed by chaos. So be patient with the crippledness of the world. Do not overvalue its consummate It's consummate beauty. Just give me a second. There's a footnote there. Now I'm going to end there. And I think that right there, it just speaks volumes about, I mean, and he's not trying to be anything. He was on a mission to learn more about himself, and that anyone should get a hold of this, that don't look at him like a prophet as a teacher, but this is his own journey. But there is something you find if you understand him and you and can relate and take from him the things that you think that you can relate to that are truths for you as well. But and he said, and he's, I mean, that's just, that's what it's all about to me. I've always been that way. We need to learn how to let people be free and truly live. And I'm not just talking about, oh yeah, we can live. I mean, I'm talking about get rid of, you know, without these systems, without, you know, we're really trying to, in our society, a lot of you understand that we really have a lot of control over how people should live and how people and don't look out there and for things and to find your way. Find your way in here. You know, that's and we should all be left, we should all be allowed to live that way. When we live that way, we'll find others that we can relate with, and then we'll build a community that way, instead of forcing people to live together and forcing people to learn certain things. And I just think that's very profound. I can't speak highly enough of the importance of that last those few passages that I read. He really, you know, it just makes sense. You know, he's a very common sense, he was a very common sense person. Common sense approach to things, and that's the, I'm not going to simplify who he was as a human being, but he's just profound, and I can just relate so much. And I want to thank you for joining me, if you're still with me. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you may have learned a little something about yourself and can relate to what he talked about. And you may have something that maybe you can explain better for me. I know I struggled with trying to understand some things. For the most part, I think I understood what he was getting at. And a lot of this, again, is his personal journey. And like he was saying, you know, don't... You know, he's not trying to teach you how to live, but he does want to share what he thinks we're all about. And that's my kind of, at a high level, seeing the forest for the trees and what he's doing here with this book. So I hope you enjoyed, and I hope you're relaxed or falling asleep and all that. And thank you again for joining me. Stay tuned for another little exploration into this book. Some other section of it and try to understand some other things. I'll try to find some good parts to read. So again, thanks, and I would like you to consider looking more into Carl Jung yourself if you'd like to learn more, and never stop trying to, you know, find, you know, explore and keep your options open and your possibilities, and keep an open mind. And try not to get caught up in overthinking, and just try to live a more simple life as far as what you spend time on and thinking and things like that. Try not to spend too much time on that. Okay, I'm going to stop now, and thanks again. Until next time, take care. Bye-bye.